Hello, this is Sandra Kennedy, pastor at Whole Life Ministries in Augusta, Georgia. Listen, I am so excited. We're on number three of our messages that have to do with paying attention to the coming of Jesus the first time and finding patterns and clues to his return when he's getting ready to come back. It is amazing what we used to call the Christmas story, what it has to do in Luke chapter 1 and chapter 2, how it tells us to look for things for his second coming. You're just going to love this entire series. This one has to do with when he returned, will he find faith on the earth? It has to do, of course, Mary going up there with Elizabeth. And it's a confirmation to her to find out Elizabeth really was pregnant and to see what was happening. And then Elizabeth's response to Mary. And Mary's response was, "Be it done unto me according to thy word." What faith in a young teenage girl looking for and believing the word of God. My goodness, let you and I keep looking. So today, we're going to be talking about the power of faith. Now, through the years, I've taught many messages about faith, but this is a little different angle. And we go to Luke chapter 1. Let's pick up in Luke chapter 1, verse 39. So let's begin reading. "Now at this time, Mary arose," at what time? "At the time that she had said, okay, be it unto me, okay. I believe what you said, so let it happen." That's in essence what she's saying. "Mary arose and went in a hurry to the hill country, to the city of Judea. Because remember, she was told by Gabriel that she has a cousin who's in the 60s. In her 60s, we found that much out last time. In her 60s, and she was told that that cousin was pregnant, who would be Elizabeth. And all of this is supernatural. So she was Mary was told this. Now keep in mind, Elizabeth was not told that Mary would be pregnant. So stay with me, okay? But Mary knew Elizabeth would. "And at this time Mary arose and went to a country, to a hill country, to a city of Judea, and entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. And when Elizabeth heard Mary's greetings, the baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. And she cried out with a loud voice and said, 'Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And how has it happened to me that the mother of my Lord would come to me? For behold, when the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby leaped in my womb for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what had been spoken to her by the Lord.' And Mary said, 'My soul exalts the Lord. My spirit has rejoiced in God my Savior, for he has regard for the humble state of his bondslave or his handmaid. For behold, from this time on, all generations will count me blessed. For the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. And his mercy is upon generation after generation. Toward those who fear him, he has done mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in the thoughts of their heart. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, and he has exalted those who were humble. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent away the rich empty-handed, and he has given help to Israel his servant in remembrance of his mercy, as he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham and to his seed," or his descendants, "forever." And Mary stayed with her about 3 months and then returned to her home. Now let's pull all that together as we talk about the power of faith. These again are patterns to look for the coming of the Lord. What will be happening around you? Now remember, everybody won't see it. Everybody could, but everybody doesn't walk in faith. Everybody doesn't believe. And you'll see how important it is that you make up your mind to believe. So on arrival, she burst in the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. And at the sound of Mary's voice, Elizabeth felt two things. At the sound of the voice. Now pay attention to me. Sound of the voice. The baby in her womb jumped. Number two, Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. At the sound of Mary's voice. Now hang on to that. Nobody's there but Elizabeth and Mary. Now this Elizabeth, it's just amazing to me. Elizabeth knew the minute that she heard Mary's greetings, knew that something, she knew a lot of things. I'll tell you what they are in a minute, but she knew something had happened. And instantly upon hearing, hello, immediately, shalom, Elizabeth. That's all that would have been said. That's all. We were not having a conversation. It was, hello, Elizabeth, or shalom, Elizabeth. And at the greeting, that's what the Bible says, at the greeting, Elizabeth is filled with the Holy Spirit and begins to prophesy. She's never prophesied in her life. And she began to prophesy. I can guarantee you one thing, when she finished prophesying, I guarantee you she said, where did that come from? I guarantee you that. I promise you, where did that come from? And particularly what she said. I mean, all of our lives are dependent on what she said. It's amazing things that she said. Look at what she said. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. Praise God. How did Elizabeth know Mary was pregnant? Come on, 3 or 4 weeks pregnant? Come on. See, we think that somebody told Elizabeth. There wasn't anybody to tell Elizabeth but the Holy Spirit. And he didn't tell her, obviously, until she showed up. What a God we serve. Next, Elizabeth declared her faith in Jesus months before Jesus was even born. What'd she say? And how has it happened to me that the mother of my Lord would come to me? Wow, yes. Now, she called him my Lord. How did she know to say that? Right. Wow. I mean, we don't see anybody. There's no sign. And Mary says, how did the mother of my Lord, how favored I am that you would come. I can imagine Mary just standing there. Can you imagine such? Mary said, huh? I promise you, it has not all processed in her yet. She was going up there to see if it was real. Then she said, for behold, when the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby leaped in my womb for joy. Take note, the sound, in other words, when the word, a single word spoken to Mary, to Elizabeth, had a profound result. Imagine if one word you spoke would fill somebody with the Holy Spirit. I'm telling you, there's power in the spoken word. And we rattle on like whatever. There is power in the word that comes out of your mouth. The Lord's waiting on us to wake up to these things. And then she said, blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what had been spoken to her by the Lord. Again, you know, Mary hadn't said anything to Elizabeth except hello. Shalom means hello. Hello. Peace, whatever you want to call it. It was the Holy Spirit that told Elizabeth. But I want to tell you something. Elizabeth had to be open to hear. That's right. How open to hear are you in these days? How open are you to hear unusual things from your usual people? Strange ways. I mean, Elizabeth had to be open to it. What are we going to do today when out of the clear sky somebody comes in and somebody says, I'm telling you, God told me he's coming now. You just go look at, oh, ho-hum, that's just old Sally. God does unusual things with unusual people in unusual ways. That is a pattern. Glory to God. Now, the challenge to our faith, friends, is not our inability to hear God's voice. We hear him. How do I know we hear him? Jesus said so. He said, my sheep hear my voice. Now, everybody who's born again, the Bible says, hears the voice of God. Jesus said, you hear my voice. Mine and your problem is not whether we hear the voice of God. Mine and your problem is hearing everything else. We hear so much junk, we can't hear God. We hear our ideas. We hear the internet. We hear television. We hear traditions. We hear this. We hear family. We hear this. We hear so much junk. Who can hear God? So that's our problem. Our opinions, our attitudes come from, they compete for the attention that God's trying to give us. And Satan wants you to be so cluttered in your head that you don't know what's true and what's not true.
Would you like to live your life differently and rise above all the negative thoughts of imperfection and failure? It's time to get your mind and spirit man united so you can quote God's word and walk out his word in your life. Instead of searching the whole Bible, Sandra's scripture book of 51 topics, coupled with her 3-CD series, It's Time to Change Your Mind, will propel you to move into new dimensions with God. Call and request offer 134 or place your order online, because it's time to change the way you think.
But we need to quit focusing on our inability to hear God. We need to focus on the fact that God wants you to hear him. Now, let me ask you something. If you're trying to talk to somebody and it's obvious they're not hearing you, what do? You raise your voice. What do? You get in their face. Do you hear me? You look at them until you know they hear you. What makes you think God does not want to be heard? Don't you want people to hear you? If you've got something really to say, don't you want them to hear you? Don't you think God Almighty will rattle your cage? But we've got so much stuff, it takes us forever to hear it. And then it takes us forever to process it, because we've got so much stuff we have to deal with. I'm telling you, it's something else. God wants us to hear his voice. I tell you what our greatest problem is busyness. Now, and listen, I don't mean your schedule. I'm not talking about your schedule. Nobody was any busier than Jesus was in his last 3 years. Come on, let's give him a break here. The Bible says he didn't even have time to eat, he and his disciples. So it had nothing to do with schedule. I am not talking about how busy you are with your schedule. I am talking about that Jesus never lost touch with his Father. His schedule was extremely busy, but his heart was not. You need to write that down somewhere. His heart was not cluttered with so much stuff, unbelief, unforgiveness, tradition. I don't know what I think about that. Never heard that said before. I don't know if I buy that or not. Junk. Junk. Junk that we think we know so much. You know, on the busiest days, Jesus was conscious of God Almighty. He was never, never out of his thoughts. He was busy, I'm going to say it again, but his heart was not busy. Every time the Lord does something supernatural, be it a healing, a word of prophecy, whatever it is he's doing, he's trying to anchor your soul in the very fact that there is a supernatural spirit realm. He's trying to get you to tune to it. Isn't that what Paul said when he said, what you can't see is eternal, but what you do see is only temporary? So why are we moved more by what we do see than what we don't see? There are things, for instance, the Bible teaches that heaven, it's on its way down, that heaven is close to us. We know that the presence of God is right here on us, and that angelic beings are here, and God never leaves us, and our angels are with us everywhere we go and everything we do, and we can't see it, so we don't believe it. What you can't see, but you can see in your heart. What you know that you know that you know. You can't see your mansion, but bless God, we got one. You can't see the streets ago, but they're there. I want to tell you, your life depends on God's voice. You better listen to me. That's why the word says, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. We must hear God's voice. What is he saying now? What is he saying to you to do at your house? What is he saying for you to do about your plans? What is he saying for your next step? What does he say where your attention should be? What is God saying? We need to hear his voice. Amen. The Bible says faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. I want to tell you, there can be no doubt that Mary heard the voice of God consistently through her young life. I mean, this Magnificat that we were about to read here proves that. Proves that. She was filled with the Word before the Word came to dwell in her. We're talking about the power of faith. That's believing. The power of faith. The power of faith, the power of believing was the seed that made Mary pregnant.
Yes.
If she had not believed, she would not be pregnant. Do you understand? At what moment was she pregnant? At the very moment she accepted the seed. When she accepted the seed, the minute she heard it for a second, be it unto me, okay. Okay, okay, okay. At that moment, she was pregnant. The moment you accept something God has put in you, no matter what it is, the moment you take the word of God, be it for healing, be it for deliverance, be it for whatever it is, financial breakthrough, for whatever it is that you need from God. The moment you take his word and you make it yours, I believe that, and I hold on to that, and I'm holding you accountable to your word. That moment you become pregnant for that thing to show itself. And it works like a seed. But the problem is we go and dig up seeds to see if it's producing. And so we mess the whole thing up. So we start all over again. How many people go out, you plant a tomato bush? I mean, not a bush, but a seed. You go out and nothing's coming. You go out there and look at it. So you dig down there. Is it working? No, you just killed it. You got to start over.
Amen.
I'm telling you something there that can change your life. You don't have enough money to pay for that kind of revelation. What promise has the Lord said to you that you've taken to heart? Can your guardian angel say this morning of you, blessed is she or blessed is he who has believed that there will be a fulfillment of what was spoken to him or her by the Lord? Can your guardian angel, who's with you constantly, no matter how nasty you are, how ugly you are, whether you want him there or not, invited or uninvited, your guardian angel does not leave you. Here's everything that's going on. Could he say, hey, Lord, blessed is this one. She believed what you told her. She holding on to it. We got something to work with. Mm-hmm. Since we're looking for a pattern in his first coming that points to his second coming, can your guardian angel today testify before the Lord that you believe what you cannot yet see with your physical eye? Do you really believe Jesus is coming back soon?
Yes.
No, everybody in here says, oh, I know he's coming back. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. I ain't believing that in 2,000 years. Oh, yeah, count me in that group. No, that's not what I'm asking. Do you believe he could come back, will come back, will, in your lifetime?
Yes.
Do you believe he could come back in this next year?
Yes.
At the max? At the max?
Yes, yes.
He said, when I come back, will I find faith on the earth? What does he mean? Faith, believing I will come back. I mean, that's not complicated. When I come back, will anybody believe in I'm coming back? Will anybody be looking for me to come back? Will anybody be planning for me to come back?
Yes.
I'm talking about patterns for the second coming. And God says, without faith, it's impossible to please God. I want to show you something that will just make you awe at a 14-year-old. The Magnificat is a declaration of who God is and what God does. Now this is what this 14-year-old opened her heart, and it just came out of her mouth. Right after Elizabeth talked to her, they still hadn't had a conversation. This is right after Elizabeth said to her, "And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what has been spoken to her by the Lord." This is her still in awe. We've not even seen Zechariah yet. Now look at what she did in verse 46. Mary said, "My soul exalts the Lord." Soul, mind, will, and emotions. Isn't it amazing that Mary knew that? Then she said in verse 47, "And my spirit rejoices in God my Savior." This is really unique. Her spirit rejoiced despite any questions or doubts that she had. You write this on the tablet of your heart. Do you understand that this is a huge statement that's being made here? Do you know that your spirit can be rejoicing in the Lord when your mind is going in 100 different directions? Your mind can be, and your spirit's responding to the word of God and just rejoicing, and yet your mind says, "Oh, how's this going to be?" That's huge. Verse 48, "For he has regarded the humble state of his bondslave." Now, she's still just talking. I mean, this is just like this, back to back. This is just happening, just like this. She understood humility. She saw herself as a servant or a slave of God. She says, "I'm no better than my ancestors. I don't know why he chose me. I have no earthly idea why he chose me. Is this really real? Why did he choose me? Who's going to believe me? They all think I've been out shacking up with somebody. Nobody's going to believe me. Nobody's going to honor this child. I'm going to be ridiculed. I'm going to be made fun of. Nobody's going to believe me." Don't think she didn't go through that. She did. Verse 49, she exalts the holiness of God. She declares, verse 50, she declares his endless mercy. 51, she declares his strength. 52, she declares his attitude toward the proud and the humble. 53, she declares that he feeds the poor literally and spiritually, but rejects those who consider themselves rich. 54, she declares that God can be counted on to help Israel because his mercy is forever. 55, she declares his faithfulness beginning with her forefather Abraham, all the way down to every generation of the children of Abraham. She proclaimed God's promise to send the one through whom all the nations will be blessed, and that is Jesus, the Messiah. And on top of that, she said, "Dear God, I'm it. I'm carrying it. I'm carrying the house, the Son of God." And you know that the true children of Abraham are those who believe God and his word. So she's talking about you and me. That's what she was talking about. This is what she's really saying. God spoke throughout the centuries, throughout the history of our people, from the time of Abraham to this present day. But now, she says, now this was 2,000 years ago, but now God is ready to give his final word, and his name is Jesus. Mary was not blessed because she gave birth to Jesus. She was blessed because she believed. Amen. If you don't hear anything else, you have to hear that today. We're talking about the power of faith. We're talking about the power of believing. I'm telling you, you have to make your mind up. We're on a journey. The next pattern. Do you believe the signs? What is it you want me to believe? That Jesus is coming. That's what we're talking about. Patterns in the first coming that show his second coming. And so the key here is faith. Do you really believe he could come at any moment? Then I guess we could ask the question, how are you and I carrying him? After dozens of prophets, God sent his final word to this world in the person of Jesus, his beloved son. Please hear the pattern. Please hear what I'm saying to you. These things are being fulfilled in front of your very eyes. What does it mean to you? Or does it mean anything? He has no rival. He has no equal. He's king and always will be. His kingdom will have no end. He's Lord, Savior, Redeemer, the Lion of Judah, the Lamb of God. He's everything for everyone. His name is above every other name, and at His name every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that He is Lord. Two little sentences, listen to me. Mary was the first to see Him as a newborn baby because her faith said yes to the impossible. Amen. Did you get that?
Yes.
You and I have the same opportunity to see Him when He comes, not as a baby, but as our glorious King, if you have faith. That's why He would say, when I return, will I find faith when He comes in His appearing? We're talking about rapture. When He comes in His appearing, will you be watching for me? Then we could say, okay, unusual things, unusual people, unusual ways. Even so, come, Lord Jesus.
Would you like to live your life differently and rise above all the negative thoughts of imperfection and failure? It's time to get your mind and spirit man united so you can quote God's Word and walk out His Word in your life. Instead of searching the whole Bible, Sandra's scripture book of 51 topics, coupled with her 3-CD series, It's Time to Change Your Mind, will propel you to move into new dimensions with God. Call and request offer 134 or place your order online, because it's time to change the way you think.
Thank you for watching our program today. If you need prayer, don't just sit out there alone. Pick up the phone and call our prayer line. Our prayer warriors are there to pray and to stand with you. Go to sandrakennedy.org and go to the media tab, and you can see and go to all of our archives of our Sunday services, our healing explosions, our healing center. And don't forget again, our healing center streams every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 11 a.m. Eastern Time.
Would you like to live your life differently and rise above all the negative thoughts of imperfection and failure? It's time to get your mind and spirit man united so you can quote God's Word and walk out His Word in your life. Instead of searching the whole Bible, Sandra's scripture book of 51 topics, coupled with her 3-CD series, It's Time to Change Your Mind, will propel you to move into new dimensions with God. Call and request offer 134 or place your order online, because it's time to change the way you think. Thank you.